Dear colleagues, welcome to the Brera Astronomical Observatory Museum in Milan. I'm very pleased to the International Remote Astronomy Olympiads can begin. We assure that we all would like the Olympics to be held in person, but despite the problem relates to the pandemic and after they were unfortunately cancelled last year, we strongly wanted to propose an edition to be held remotely. This will be the first remote edition, and we hope for all of us that it will be the last. That is, that we can be back in attendance starting next year. If we are here today, we have to thank the Italian Ministry of Education, which supports the organization of the Italian Olympics and our participation in the International Olympics. For the 2022, the Ministry of Education has announced and implemented, together with the Italian Astronomical Society and in collaboration with the Italian National Institutes of Astrophysics, the 20th edition of Italian Astronomy Olympics. Thanks also goes to the Italian Astronomical Society that organizes the various stages of the National Olympics every year. Let me personally thanks to the Secretariat of the Society for the continued support in organizing this event. Thanks goes to the Italian National Institute of Astrophysics that every year with these research and observatories is an active part in this organization. Thanks go to Council of the International Astronomy Olympics and in particular to the chairman that every year optimally organizes participation in International Olympics. Thanks go to all the members of the LOC and to the group that developed the pratic and the observational rounds. Thanks go to all the research that have given their willingness to act as invigilators. Without them, the correct conduct of the rounds would not have been possible. And finally, thanks to all the teams, you, who, with many difficulties related to the pandemic, strongly wanted to participate in this remote Olympics. So, we can start, and now let me introduce for his welcome Dr. Della Ceca, Director of the Brera Observatory, which hosts the LOC works and the works of the Italian team. Please.
Hello to everyone. Let me introduce myself. My name is Roberto Della Ceca, and I'm currently the director of the Osservatorio Astronomico di Brera in Milan. I want to just to say a few words about the observatory. The Brera Observatory is one of the top level research institutes in the world, and this is the oldest scientific institution still active in Milan. Since 2001, the observatory has become part of the Italian National Institute of Astrophysics, and then after my speech, also our president will give a speech. The observatory was founded about 260 years ago in 1764 by Father Lagrange and Father Boscovich. And since then it is located in Palazzo Brera in the center of Milan. A second very important site is located at Villa San Rocco in Merate, in Brianza, very close to Milan. And this second important site became operational about 100 years ago in 1923. I would like to remember as a main directors in our history, Barnaba Oriani, Giovanni Virginio Schiaparelli, and Giovanni Celori. The observatory staff currently counts about 100 people, divided in research staff, technical scientific staff, administrative staff, short-term staff, and many students from university, both for degree thesis and for PhD. The research area of the astronomers at the observatory spans a large range of fields, from planets to stars, from black hole to galaxy, from gamma ray bursts to cosmology. All main projects are done in collaboration with national and international institutes. The observatory is also very active in the technological research applied to the astronomical instrumentation, both from Earth and from space. It is one of the world leaders in development of X-ray astronomical optics and, more in general, of light instrumentation for space missions. Several important laboratories used to carry out this technological research are located in Merate. Merate also hosts one of the three data analysis centers of the SWIFT satellite. In the historical site here in Milan, where we are now, there is also the Museum of All the Astronomical Instrumentation that you can see on my background, that were used by astronomers of the observatory in the past, an important historical archive, an ancient library with more than 29,000 books, and a modern library with more than 1,000 books, and two completely renewed domes, the Zagar Dome and the Schiaparelli Dome. These domes are devoted to public conference, students, workshop, and so on. Two historical domes are also located in Merate and open to public and to the school. This said, I am very, very happy and proud to host this competition here at the observatory. These young people, young scientists, represent our probes to see far away and to enter in the future. Good luck and good competition to everyone. Enjoy your stay here.
Okay, thank you, Roberto. Now let me introduce for his welcome Professor Paolo De Bernardis, President of the National Committee for the Celebration of Angelo Secchi. Please, Professor.
Thank you very much. It's my great pleasure to deliver the greetings of the Committee of the Italian Ministry of Culture and Heritage for the celebration of Angelo Secchi, SJ. In the 19th century, Angelo Secchi has been the real initiator of astrophysics in the literal sense, acquiring for the first time spectroscopic measurements of stars and interpreting them using the laws and methods of physics, thus joining astronomy and the physics in a powerful unicum. This happened just a few years after Kirchhoff and Bunsen had developed the laboratory spectroscopy as a method for chemical analysis, in an epoch where astronomy was mainly devoted to the study of the positions of stars and planets in the celestial sphere. Secchi has a different, deep belief, which is best explained in his own words, which were: the study of prismatic spectra of stars is not just a curiosity. The solution of many extremely important and different astronomical questions relies on it. Following this idea and the more general conviction that physical laws, as experimented in our laboratories, have universal validity, he developed a lifelong research program on the physics of astronomical sources. Giants are those scientists able to revolutionize a branch of science by means of innovative ideas and investigation methods. In this sense, Angelo Secchi has certainly been a giant, and all modern astrophysicists stand on his shoulders. His multiple contributions to the development of modern astrophysics as a discipline of physics and in several other sectors like in meteorology, geodesy, more, and his example of passion for research cannot be forgotten. And year 2018, 200 years after the birth of Angelo Secchi, he has been the occasion to revitalize studies and disseminate results on his scientific achievements. More than 2 years of promotion activity from our committee produced a wealth of conferences, events, papers, and books, all focusing on Angelo Secchi, his research, and the present-day relevance of his message. You are invited to check out the committee webpage to exploit a bit of that material. Promoting and supporting the involvement of the younger generations in astronomy has been one of the privileged goals of the committee. So we have been really glad, following the advice of Professor Roberto Bonanno, committee member, to support the important event of the International Astronomy Olympiad. We thought that proposing the figure of Angelo Secchi in the occasion would have been inspirational. So you will hear about all these in a while, following the movie on Angelo Secchi, created by Professor Roberto Bonanno, and the presentation from the committee member and friend, Professor Capuzzo Dolcetta. To conclude, I wish to you all to enjoy the participation in this special Olympics, and a future of interest and maybe passion for scientists, for science, as Angelo Secchi, with his lifespan example, taught us, being curious and studying science can shape a better life and a better society.
Thank you, Professor De Bernardis. Now, let me introduce for his welcome Professor Marco Tavani, President of the National Institute of Astrophysics. Please.
Yes, I'm very happy to be with you today. Let me say a few words, also the greetings on behalf of the Institute of Astrophysics, which is one of the leading research institutes in Italy, under the supervision of the Ministry of Research. We do astronomy and astrophysics of all sorts. We have 16 observatories and institutes across Italy. We have several telescopes and installations outside Italy. So we are very active in a variety of fields, from stars, galaxies, cosmologies and fundamental physics, planets, exoplanets, high energy physics. So it's a very broad scientific endeavor. And of course, we have many people working in the field, and especially a long tradition that was already mentioned. Angelo Secchi, of course, is the 1800. But of course, we go back to the modern science, the foundations of modern science, Galileo, of course, the Academy of Lincei, and about a century later, the Academy of Lincei, 1603, we have, which was the first academy, this, the first scientific academy of the world. We have the foundations of observatories. We have very beautiful and very important historical observatories. You see that they are in Milan, one of them, but we have crucial observatories in Italy, which really did a lot of science in the 1700, 1800, and of course also now are deeply involved in international projects. We are, of course, very interested in participating not only in national and European projects, but also international projects. International really means international collaborations of all countries interested in astronomy and astrophysics across the world. Let me mention just a few cases. One is this super radio telescope that will be installed in South Africa and Australia, with a lot of participating members in Europe, China, and also other countries, which is called SKA, which will really be a very important project for cosmology and radio astronomy for the next decade. We have, of course, our ESO telescopes in Chile, which of course are our main asset for doing really frontier astronomy at the moment. We have this project for this gigantic, really gigantic telescope, the most, in some way, largest telescope that would be constructed, ELT, extremely large telescope in Chile. And just a few days ago, the United States astronomy community produced what they call the decadal survey. They also are very interested, of course, in building big telescopes. They have the 30-meter telescopes that would like to install somewhere in the US, but the European extremely large telescope will be even bigger than the US telescope. And so it's really a challenge. It, of course, is a difficult endeavor, but Italy is deeply involved in making these kind of projects really a success. And of course, this has to be prepared with a lot of work, with planning, with the training of young people, because this is really the astronomy and astrophysics that will be done in the 2030s, 2040s. Okay, so we are really doing this work for you guys, because young people really will be very crucial to be active now in preparation of what will happen in a few years. Okay. And of course, there are other projects now. I don't have time to talk about those, also in high energy. But we really devote a lot of effort, especially in recent years, to the outreach of astronomy and also teaching and didactical projects. This is very important. The Olympic event today is an example. We have many other examples across Italy. We also have an initiative of the International Astronomical Union for the Mediterranean area. So we are really somewhat keen in pursuing the teaching and outreach of astronomy in our society. Astronomy is very close to society. It should be perceived as an ancient science, which was, of course, invented for very practical purposes, okay, navigation, geolocalization, time. So this was a very practical thing. So astronomy is not far away, but very close. So I'm really happy to wish you all the best for this competition. And you will have, at the end of this experience, have participated in this wonderful event, thinking that astronomy is really a carrier of knowledge, of course, human understanding, but also of peace and of an interconnected world, which is what we really want to achieve. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Tavani. Now let me introduce from his welcome, Professor Flavio Fusipecci, that is here, Vice President of the Italian Astronomical Society. Please.
Thank you. It's a pleasure to be here, of course, and I want to say just a few words, a few notes, which are important to me. The first one is that the Astronomy Olympics represent a very important event of training, knowledge, and friendship. To me, this is the second point which is important, because all the boys, all the girls who are participating in this event, being everywhere in the world, but they work and participate to be all friends. That may be a silly thing, but it's very important at the end. And astronomy is very important in this sense. We can be all together talking about astronomy and being friends. And in this view, I have the pleasure to thank Professor Gravelo, who is not here now, but who for many years has been dedicating his ability and his time to make it happen. That is another aspect which is important. In this context, I believe that there is another point which is important, which is that all those, the students, but also people working, the teachers and so on, are doing something which goes far beyond their duty. In other words, everybody working in this field is trying to do something which may be better, more important, and is not something which is due, something which has been chosen, something which is will be important for their formation, for the evolution of their ideas, for the opening their minds. So that is important. So in this context, it's quite easy to, in a sense, to conclude, just saying that on behalf of the entire Italian Astronomical Society and Professor Buonanno, who is not here just because he is in the hospital, so he cannot intervene, and testify that for us, this is very important. This activity is one of the main things that we can do in our society, and this involves the Minister of Education at the highest level, and this year over 10,000 students and about 500 teachers in many schools everywhere in Italy. All the regions are involved. And we have also 50 professional astronomers who are members of the University of the National Institute of Astrophysics who are working on this project. This may be, in a sense, apparently, one might say, is not so wide at the end. Why not 1 million people? Why not this and this? But this is important because it shows that we want to do something all together. So I have to thank everyone who is working to make this happen. And of course, good luck to all the students who are competing now, but also to all the students we are not competing here today, but who were involved somehow at the beginning. Because starting from the first steps, this is an important project to try to improve our knowledge, but also the curiosity, the idea that we have to learn something, we have to participate, we have to try to put our efforts in a curious game. And it's not so important to be the first in the world. What is important is that we have opened our mind, we have opened our head, we know something better, we are friends of other people, we know that we are all doing something which is curious and important for all of us. So, good luck. Who knows who will win? Maybe Italians, who knows? Everybody will be accepted. We are making no choice. We, all of us, we have already won.
Won, yes.
How is the word in English?
Won.
Okay. So that is very important. So, dear friends, be friends.
Okay.
Thank you, Professor Cusipecci. Thanks again. Now let me introduce from his welcome Professor Anna Brancaccio, representative of the Ministry of Education. Please, Professor.
Thank you. Good morning, everyone. I'm very happy to be here to open this international astronomy competition. I bring greetings from the Minister, Prof. Patrizio Bianchi, and the Director General of the Department that promotes and finances these Olympics. These Olympics are very important for the Ministry of Education because they allow interdisciplinary activities for students of various school levels. This year, the health situation for the COVID has prevented the competition from being held in the presence. And even in these various participating states, there are still situations of closure. We hope in the next year, when Italy will host the international competition again, we can be in attempts to grasp the spirit of international collaboration. Today, however, we appreciate the digital that allows us to realize the Olympics, even if at a distance. The Olympics are an important opportunity for students because they bring out excellence and are stimulating for everyone to learn and study more and more. The Ministry of Education rewards the winners of the Olympics of all disciplines by entering the names in a register and giving them a cash prize. The Ministry promotes competitions in various disciplines. I conclude by giving good luck to the participants, that the best may win. But I can say, also with Flavio, that everyone that is here has already won to be here. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Pancaccio. There is a speech of Mikhail Gavrilov, chairman of the International Astronomy Olympics. Because he has some problem with the audio-video connection, he sent me his speech, and so I read it. Dear colleagues, organizers, team leaders, and contestants. Dear colleagues, ladies and gentlemen, it is my great pleasure to welcome you to the International Remote Astronomy Olympiad, which is organized with a host in Brera Astronomical Observatory in Milan. Allow me to begin with some words of thanks. First, I would like to express my heartfelt appreciation to the organizers, the Italian Astronomical Society, Brera Astronomical Observatory, National Institutes for Astrophysics, and all organizations involved. My appreciation to the participating team. Almost 100 talented and motivated young astronomy enthusiasts for various regions of the world will take part in this Olympiad. I hope the days of the Olympiad, although organizing in a remote format, will be stimulating and enriching, and I naturally wish you all the best at the Olympiad. In the coming days, you are going to engage each other in academy demanding, but friendly competition involving three rounds of challenging astronomy problems. I wish you the best of luck in your endeavors. Regardless of your achievements at the round, remember that you are ready. To your national and regional Olympiads, show a talent for astronomy and other science. Most importantly, during the coming days, you will have a unique opportunity to create an international network and to initiate a lasting friendship with other people sharing your passion for science. Astronomy is a unique subject that is above any political, cultural, and societal differences between people. Astronomy provides a resumptive view to the world and nature. It is a basic science for exploring the universe. I hope later you, now presenting a different team at IRAO, will study together in the same university, and then work in wise in common scientific groups of different institutes and observatories in the world. I hope you will enjoy your stay at the national towns of the Olympiad and represent your country well as the International Remote Astronomy Olympiad. And we, as organizers, should use this Olympiad to look further ahead to the future, emphasizing the role of science in society. If you want to make a difference in the world today, we must engage with the youth. The International Remote Astronomy Olympiad 2021 is declared open. Welcome to the Olympiad. Thank you.
Okay. Thank Gabriel.
Okay. I wish to say many thanks to Gabriel, and I hope to we can hear you as soon as possible. And we prepare a short video about Angelo Secchi that was an Italian astronomer that founder of astronomical spectroscopy, as is introduced by Professor De Bernardis. He was a director of the Observatory of the Roman Colleague, and he was the first to classify the star into spectra classes. For the celebration of his bicentenary of his birth, a short movie is made and that tells about his figures. So let's go to see it.
La luce, se scomposta nel modo più opportuno, rivela la struttura più profonda dell'universo. Mi chiamo Angelo Secchi e nella luce ho trovato il modo di leggere la natura delle stelle. Nacqui nel giugno del 1818 in una famiglia modesta. Mio padre era falegname, mia madre sarta. Avevo una sorella, molto più grande di me, e un fratellastro.
Giulia?
In Giappone.
Sociale. Con Anna, la mia sorella maggiore, imparai a leggere e a scrivere. E a 15 anni, una volta finito il ginnasio, divenni un novizio dei gesuiti e lasciai la mia famiglia. A 19 anni mi spostai al collegio romano e lì iniziai gli studi di filosofia. Ma la fisica era la mia vera passione. Se ne accorse il mio professore, Giovan Battista Pianciani, che dopo solo 4 anni mi spedì a Loreto a insegnare, appunto, fisica. Nel 1847, appena prima dei miei 30 anni, presi i voti e tornai a Roma. Un anno ancora e la storia e la politica irruppero nella mia vita. Tutta Europa ribolliva di tumulti e anche gli stati del Santo Padre non vennero risparmiati. Non mi era ben chiaro il motivo per il quale tanta gente venisse a far rumore sotto le finestre della nostra casa, finché mi dissero che il Papa era fuggito e che avrei dovuto raccogliere le mie cose e scappar via. E con me tutti i miei confratelli. Prima fuggii in Gran Bretagna e poi negli Stati Uniti. Era il 1848, un anno terribile in tutta Europa. Lasciai l'Inghilterra quando padre Francesco De Vico, il mio professore di matematica e astronomia al Collegio Romano, fuggito anche lui da Roma, mi propose di raggiungerlo a Georgetown. Salpai alla volta degli Stati Uniti. L'ambiente del college era dinamico e cordiale e il direttore del locale osservatorio, padre James Carley, mi volle subito come assistente. De Vico, Carley. Ora i pilastri erano due. La strada era chiara e tracciata. Una strada che puntava alle stelle. L'anno dopo fui richiamato in Italia. La Repubblica Romana era caduta, il Papa di nuovo al suo posto e il Collegio Romano mi aspettava, stavolta come direttore dell'Osservatorio Astronomico. Un incarico gravoso, ma sapevo esattamente cosa fare. Trovai un disastro. Durante i moti del 48, i rivoluzionari avevano fatto irruzione, devastando e saccheggiando qualsiasi cosa avessero trovato. E un'ala dell'edificio era perfino andata a fuoco. Ancora mi vengono i brividi a pensare che poco più di un anno prima sedevo in quelle stanze lamentandomi di tutto quel vociare che si sentiva dalla strada. I locali assegnati all'osservatorio erano comunque inadeguati a quanto avevo intenzione di realizzare e non mi ci volle molto per convincere addirittura il Santo Padre a finanziare la costruzione di una nuova struttura. Feci costruire il nuovo osservatorio proprio sul tetto della chiesa di Sant'Ignazio, facendo mia un'idea di Ruggero Boscovich. La chiesa avrebbe dovuto avere una cupola che però non fu mai realizzata. Si trattava allora di approfittare dei quattro enormi pilastri che sarebbero dovuti servire per sorreggerla, per sostenere invece il peso dell'osservatorio. Una volta finiti i lavori, feci trasportare tutte le apparecchiature nei nuovi locali. C'era un telescopio Cochua per le osservazioni solari ed un circolo meridiano Hertel, ma lo strumento più importante era un telescopio equatoriale MERS di 22 centimetri di apertura, una macchina nuovissima, la più grande in Italia. Con questi strumenti ero pronto a guardare le stelle con occhi diversi. Cominciai ad applicare i miei studi di fisica alle osservazioni astronomiche e insieme a un pugno di astronomi visionari fondai la nuova astronomia, l'astrofisica. Per conoscere i corpi celesti non bastava più contarli e studiarne le orbite. Era necessario capirne la composizione a partire dalla loro temperatura. Cominciai allora a studiare il sole, le macchie e le facole. Disegnavo le nebulose che osservavo, le comete, i pianeti. E più studiavo, più rimanevo colpito dall'intima armonia del cosmo, a partire dall'unitarietà delle leggi fisiche. Dai miei viaggi all'estero ho capito quanto sia importante confrontarsi con gli altri. Arroccarsi nel proprio sapere era ormai esercizio del passato e per questo pubblicai i risultati degli studi con regolarità, in modo da poterli condividere coi miei colleghi e tenerne un archivio. La scienza deve essere al servizio del bene comune e assistere l'umanità nel progresso, altrimenti rischia di rimanere solo un esercizio intellettuale. Pubblicare e condividere. Per me era la cosa più naturale del mondo. Però, quando il nuovo Stato italiano mi propose la cattedra di astronomia fisica alla Sapienza, fui tacciato di connivenza coi nemici di Sua Santità e ovviamente fui costretto a rifiutare. Decisi allora di rimanere confinato all'interno dell'osservatorio, confidando però sempre nella volontà del Signore. Capii allora che bisognava superare la maniera isolata nella quale la nostra comunità aveva da sempre condotto il proprio lavoro. cominciai con una serie di pubblicazioni, le memorie dell'Osservatorio del Collegio Romano, a cui presto seguì il bullettino meteorologico dell'Osservatorio del Collegio Romano, che ebbe un notevole successo. Naturalmente non mi dedicavo soltanto allo studio del cielo, ma continuavo a occuparmi di tutte le incombenze civili che lo Stato mi richiedeva. Un lavoro che mi sembrava della massima importanza per rendere più moderno lo Stato pontificio fu quello di realizzare la base geodetica sulla via Appia. Misurammo con l'accuratezza di un centimetro la distanza tra un punto al centro della via Appia, vicino al monumento di Cecilia Metella, e uno sulla torre di Frattocchie. 12.043 metri e 14 centimetri. Anche la meteorologia ha sempre suscitato in me un grande interesse, vuoi per la sua rilevanza civile che per la sua complessità scientifica. E poiché in scienza bisogna sempre partire dai dati, realizzai un meteorografo. Un apparecchio in grado di registrare e trascrivere autonomamente una grande quantità di dati atmosferici. Questo strumento mi valse uno speciale riconoscimento all'Esposizione Universale di Parigi nel 1867. Un altro progetto importante fu quello di migliorare il servizio dell'ora alla città di Roma. Il Santo Padre, uomo dalle vedute moderne, stabilì che la città avesse dovuto abbandonare l'ora italiana. L'ora italiana era un metodo per calcolare la giornata che si basava sull'intervallo di tempo tra l'alba e il tramonto. Le ore estive duravano così quasi il doppio di quelle invernali. Ma la cosa funzionava e i romani vi si erano abituati da tempo. Però in tutta Europa già usavano un sistema molto più moderno ed era opportuno adottarlo anche nello Stato Pontificio. Ne seguì una gran confusione. Il Santo Padre stabilì allora che fosse dato ai romani un segnale univoco. A mezzogiorno in punto, una salva di cannone sarebbe partita da Castel Sant'Angelo e sarebbe stata udita da tutta la città. Il cannone avrebbe sparato solo dopo aver ricevuto un segnale dal Collegio Romano, visibile in linea d'aria. Inizialmente dall'osservatorio veniva issata una bandiera, ma non era molto affidabile. Si pensò allora di far salire una grande cesta nera su un'asta alta 6 metri e farla cadere al preciso scoccare del mezzogiorno. La cesta, ben zavorrata, era un segnale molto più preciso della bandiera e funzionava anche in caso di forte vento. Gli astronomi classici, i puristi, continuavano a non vedere di buon occhio che la loro disciplina fosse invasa da studi che appartenevano alla fisica, e i nuovi strumenti che andavano ad arricchire l'osservatorio erano per loro completamente alieni e minacciosi. Io però andavo avanti, comunque. Non dimenticavo che, giusto qualche piano sotto l'osservatorio, vi era ancora una grande sala. Una sala nella quale un mio illustre predecessore volle allestire il Museo del Mondo. Padre Athanasius Kircher, 150 anni prima che io nascessi, nutrì l'ambizione di riunire tutte le scienze e le arti in un grande patrimonio di sapere, facente capo a Dio. Una visione superata, certo, ma mi ricordava che far convergere diverse branche della scienza è un processo a cui si può aspirare. Anche qui, al Collegio Romano, dove la ricerca scientifica è sempre stata di casa. E ora, in questo spazio senza tempo, riesco finalmente a capire quanto la mia epoca sia stata fondamentale per lo studio dei fenomeni naturali. Noi non lo sapevamo, ma stavamo ponendo le basi per la comprensione profonda della natura e dello scenario nel quale la materia agisce. Quando ero in vita, noi astronomi abbiamo cominciato a indagare l'universo, scomponendo la luce nelle diverse lunghezze d'onda. E abbiamo creato uno strumento di indagine più sottile, quasi un bisturi, affilatissimo. Per utilizzare questo strumento in maniera coordinata, un gruppo di noi, ormai astronomi italiani, ha creato la Società degli Spettroscopisti Italiani. Dopo aver identificato anche nelle stelle gli stessi elementi chimici che trovavamo sulla Terra, ho utilizzato gli spettri per suddividere le stelle per classe di appartenenza. Personalmente ne ho catalogate più di 4.000. E il Sole è una di queste stelle, classificabile esattamente come le altre. Le macchie, i getti di materia, le facole, i brillamenti che registravamo contemporaneamente da diversi punti di osservazione, da Roma alla Sicilia, le protuberanze che osservavamo durante le eclissi solari e la presenza stessa della corona, ci davano indicazioni sui fenomeni complessi che avvenivano sulla sua superficie. Tutti questi fenomeni erano attribuibili alle condizioni fisiche della fotosfera del Sole. Ed è alla temperatura del Sole, in definitiva, che possono essere fatti risalire gli effetti meteorologici che hanno riempito di passione la mia vita di scienziato. È la luce che ci indica l'unità del cosmo. Lungo questi studi, un nuovo senso di meraviglia ci pervade. L'universo non è più un disegno che tracciamo notte dopo notte, ma una struttura concreta e riconoscibile. Una struttura di cui noi facciamo parte. In eredità ho lasciato a questa Terra un secolo di progressi enormi e ogni nuova scoperta ha portato nuovi interrogativi, nuove frontiere da scandagliare e nuovi strumenti di indagine. L'osservazione della natura, il tentativo di comprendere il mondo, era una missione per la mia coscienza di gesuita e l'ho affrontata con rigore e umiltà, sempre contemplando l'opera del Creatore. Dio disse, sia la luce. E la luce fu. Dio vide che la luce era una cosa buona e separò la luce dalle tenebre.
Okay, then thank you. And now let me introduce Professor Roberto Capuzzo Dolcetta from the University of Rome, La Sapienza, who will tell us about Angelo Secchi's scientific activity. The study of the star, as shown in the video, and the discovery in the star of material present also on our Earth led Secchi to propose a unitary treatment of natural phenomena and forces on a universal scale. So, please, Professor Dolcetta, to you.
Okay, thanks a lot. And I hope that you are watching my video.
Yes, it's okay.
And so I just want to get to the movie that we have seen to say something about an original view of Secchi, who is recognized as the inventor of modern astrophysics, essentially because he used spectroscopy to study light coming from the star. But actually, he has done something which is a pretty new theme in modern physics, which is the attempt to unify the fundamental physical forces. Just to remind for the students, for young people here, what are the fundamental physical forces? There is gravitation, which is a long range force, which is not at all shieldable. There is the electromagnetic force, which is a long range force too, which is shieldable actually. And there are the, let's say, modern weak nuclear force, short range, and strong nuclear force. The last is the one that puts together protons and neutrons in a nucleus. A sort of a new unification has been done actually in modern physics, at least between the electromagnetic and the weak nuclear force, giving rise to what is called the electroweak theory. And after that, some further unification has led to the so-called standard model, which is a view to unify the electroweak force and the strong nuclear force. So the unification of fundamental physical force is a problem that so far presently appears to be solved for three out of the four fundamental force in the frame of the so-called gauge theories and symmetry. And any of these three forces have a precise correspondent, what is called the messenger, which transmits the force, which are actually elementary particles, fermions or bosons. I don't want to bother you about this physics. Actually, two Nobel Prizes have been released to Abdus Salam first for the first unification, and to Rubbia and van der Meer for some fundamental experimental verification of the theory by Abdus Salam. So the ultra weak, the most ancient and pervasive force, the gravity, as a matter of fact, remains so far out of the unified scheme. You would say, and so what? What is the role of Secchi in this? Is incredible, but Secchi was a pioneer in this very modern field of physics. In 1864, he published a book called The Unity of Physical Forces. Of course, he published it in Italian. He wrote it in Italian. And in this book, he said, as you can read, he had not the ambition to provide a new philosophia naturalis like the first one by Newton, but just to present a synthesis or what was known at his time about the general study of physical phenomena. So the product was a more than 500-page book written in Italian without a single mathematical formula, which is astonishing. Actually, in the book preface, he wrote, I have to admit that the difficulty in treating the complexity of the content of this book to make it easy to understand to the largest possible audience has been much harder than I thought, of course, I would say. And so, as a matter of fact, it was a sort of science popularization book written, he said, in the scraps of time allowed by all my other duties. He had indeed a lot of other official duties. So in Secchi's intention, this book should have been simply a sort of summa of the physics knowledge at this time. But in spite of this, he had a lot of problems with his contemporary people. So actually, Secchi, as you probably understood from watching the movie, it was under attack contemporary by lay and religious people. For example, in the case of this book, Unit of Physical Forces, he was accused by a contemporary colleague, a Jesuit, who was a Thomist, Comoldi, who said, oh, Secchi adhered to Democritus' atomism and to the Cartesian theories of Bottice in astronomy, which is pretty bad. And so an embittered Secchi answered, I can only say that physics progressed a bit after St. Thomas, and I believe that were St. Thomas living at our time, he would have adopted the physics of nowadays, like he adopted the physics of his time. And he was right, of course, because St. Thomas was an intelligent and clever man. So back to the unity of physical forces. At Secchi's times, only two of what we now call fundamental forces were actually known. What? Gravitational force and electric and magnetic force. Thermodynamics has been developing at his time, as a kinetic theory, but leading to some misconception. Gravity had already had actually an unification, thanks to Newton. As you know, in the Philosophiae Naturalis Principia Mathematica, the most important result by Newton was that the Earth gravity, the one that makes the apple fall to the ground, is essentially the same thing that the celestial gravity, which is the one that makes planets revolving around the sun. This was the first unification in physics. But not just gravity, but also thanks to the work by James Clerk Maxwell, electricity and magnetism have been already unified with the beautiful scheme of the Maxwell's equation that you see on the right of this slide. And so Secchi curiously fully acknowledged in his book the Newton's work, albeit he say that essentially Newton was very great, very clever, but also lucky because he was able to collect all the previous culture about gravity to solve definitely the problem of gravity. On the other side, Secchi didn't like too much Maxwell and cited Maxwell only in a short footnote in one of the chapters of his book about unity of physical forces. Essentially, he say that as you read, Maxwell was able to join magnetism with the theory of the small vortices in Italian, Teoria dei Vorticetti. Anyway, this author, Maxwell, seems to complicate uselessly the hypothesis with the assumption of existence of certain structures in the fluid. So for some reason, he didn't acknowledge enough Maxwell while he acknowledged at all Newton. So briefly about the book, which is absolutely interesting, four chapters, the first about heat, so the essential of thermodynamics, the second about light propagation, the third about electricity, the very final one about structure of matter and gravity. In agreement with what he said in the preface of the book, actually Secchi say that he didn't want to propose a new unification theory, but actually he had in mind a unifying vision of physics, which clearly has been shown in the first chapter of his book. And his unification vision was based on the kinetic theory that has been developing at his time. Shortly, in his opinion, every microscopic small scale or macroscopic large scale phenomenon can be essentially reduced to an explanation in terms of kinetics, movement of its constituents, elementary constituents, including gravity, which is the very modern and new vision of SECI that not everybody acknowledges nowadays. Indeed, he said, at any regard, gravity should not be confused with light read, because although both arise from molecular agitation, so also gravity depends on molecular agitation, they behave differently in the modification of an environment. But essentially, also gravity is reduced to a kinetic vision. Unfortunately, this very modern idea by Secchi to connect gravity to other parts of physics required the existence of something that actually doesn't exist, the luminiferous ether, which is something that has been excluded to exist by the famous experience by Michelson Morley, but this happened just after Secchi died, so he wasn't responsible for that, because this demonstration has not been done yet. So what is the luminiferous ether? Is a sort of pervading substance where the ponderable bodies, the masses, are gravitating, and they are moving because of a transmission of motion, which is caused by the difference of the ether density caused by the bodies themselves. So first of all, note that this theory is not so different from the theory by René Descartes about vortex. So in some sense, the Jesuit Comaldi was not wrong, but apart from this, what is astonishing, at least in my opinion, is that this theory recalls a bit what is the Einstein's geometric gravitation view, because the luminiferous ether is a sort of space-time which is deformed due to the difference in ether density by the body itself, which is exactly the basic idea of general relativity. Unfortunately, like always in the book, there are also some small mistakes, like for example, what is found in one of the chapters of the book, where he, talking about gravity, says, if we add some kinetic energy to a material, so to a mass system, this corresponds to increased relative distances of its elements, and so we obtain as a final effect a reduction of gravity in a given space volume. Why? This was quite clear, because if we eat, for example, a cube of matter 1 meter side, there is an expansion. So some of the matter which was before the expansion included in 1 meter side goes out of this 1 meter. And so the mass contained in the original side is reduced, and also gravity is reduced. This was true, apparently, but it is true just on the Earth, not in the sky, because as seen later on by Rudolf Clausius, there is an astonishing property of the celestial bodies, which are actually some self-gravitating system. And this is that they have an incredible characteristic to have negative heat capacity. What does it mean? This is a result by Clausius based on his virial theorem, and simply say that, quite astonishing, while on the Earth, if you heat some matter, the temperature increase, in the sky, it is the opposite, it is the contrary. So sun and galaxies or globular cluster are self-gravitating system, which on the contrary, if you add kinetic energy, forza viva in Italian, they cool down instead of heating up. So it is absolutely clear that at least in that side, Father Secchi was wrong, but also this was not his fault, because the discovery by Clausius happened after he died. So I have to conclude just to say that the role of Secchi was essential, and not just for inventing modern astrophysics using these spectroscopical techniques by Fraunhofer and others to the stars, but also for this interesting pioneering work about a very open nowadays problem, which is the unification of physical forces, including gravity. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Professor Capuzzo Dolcetta. Now is the time to present all the team. I mean, usually when we are in presence in the other Olympiad, we call the team on the stage, in the auditorium and so on. But in this case, we call in alphabetic order all the team for their brief greeting, if they can. So we can to start with Bulgaria team. Are you connected?
Yes, I'm here. Hello, can you hear me? Hello, everyone.
Nice to see you, Nikola.
My name is Nikola Karavasilev, and I'm a team leader from Bulgaria. So my students are not with me now. That's why I will present. I would like to share my screen to present a brief presentation.
You have a presentation?
Yes, because my students are not here.
Okay. But is it just some speech just to greetings?
Ha tolto.
Deve presentare il
microfono. Okay, so now you can see our presentation, which, first of all, we would like to say hello, dear friends. So Bulgaria is a country which is in the southern part of Europe, over here. Well, we're very proud that we have invented so many important things like the Cyrillic letters, and we're a great producer of also as well. We have a lot of beautiful places to see. We have mountains, sea, and so on. So here you can see one photo of our two main cities, Sofia and Plovdiv. And now please let me introduce our team. So this is Laura. She's a student in ninth grade in Sofia High School of Mathematics. So her favorite constellation is Lyra, and the favorite star is Vega. Well, this is Stella. So she studied in the town of Haskovo. So she's ninth grade as well. So her favorite constellation is Sagitta. Well, this is Kalyan. So he's 14 years old, and he also studies in Sofia. So his favorite constellation is Taurus. Well, let me introduce Geo. So he studies in Sofia, and he loves physics and astronomy. Well, his favorite star is Ahernar, most probably because he cannot see it from his home. And the next participant, this is Bayan. So he likes to watch the world and think about it. So as you can see on the picture, well, and his favorite star is Capella from the constellation of Auriga. Well, the sixth participant is Margulan. So he lives in our sea's capital, Varna. Obviously, he has a dog named Bello. And his favorite constellation is Sagittarius. And the last but not least participant is Konstantin. So he's a participant from 11th grade. He lives in Burgas. And his favorite constellation is Lynx. So we all wish you a good luck in the Olympiad. And and thank you for your attention. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Now is the time for the Team Canada. Canadian team.
Greetings.
Nice to see you.
My name is Vera Zagainova. I am team leader and team member.
Hi, everyone. I'm Armin Hadai. I'm also a team leader for Team Canada.
My name is Emma Yao.
My name is Sunny Yao.
I'm Debbie Wang.
I'm Jenner Lee.
Good luck, everyone.
Good luck, everyone.
Thank you very much. Now is the time for Team China.
Okay. Hello, everyone. I'm here of China, and we have this year. Let me start from on my left, Wang Boyu. He's from Beijing, and he's 10th grade, right?
No, 9th grade.
9th grade, okay. Now, next one is
Qu
Yifei. He's also from Beijing. He's in 10th grade, right? And the third one is Mr. Xing Xiafan from Shandong province. And he's in 11th grade, right? 11th, okay. And we have the fourth student, Wang Junluo from Guangzhou, and he's also 12th grade. We have number five student. He was not able to be here because his plane was late. And his name is Huang Hongwei. He's joining the opening ceremony online. And we are very glad to be part of this Olympiad. And after 1 year of interruption, very happy to meet everyone. Thank you. It's over. That's the end of our introduction.
Hey,
So, hello, I'd like to introduce the Czech Republic team to all of you. So, we are the six of us here are stationed in Prague, the capital of the Czech Republic, and we will be competing from here together. At first, we'd like to thank you, to say thank you to the organizers for organizing this competition even in these difficult times. And now I will shortly introduce the names of our team. So this is David. This is Richard. This over here is Hubert.
Hello.
This is Tomáš.
Hi.
And this is Matouš.
Hi.
And my name is Honza. So the Czech Republic is a country in the middle of Europe, and we all like beer, and the Czech Republic is very famous for it. So we'd like to say hello, and we look forward to the competition, and we hope we will all have fun.
Many thanks. Thank you. Now is the time for Italy team.
Hello, everyone, from the historical Cupola Fiore in Milano, in the Brera Astronomical Observatory. These are our Italian champions.
Yeah.
Rafael Stoppa.
Hi, I'm Alessandra Caggetta. Milena Duccio. Victoria Corotto.
And I'm Daniele Spiga, team leader. This is the jury member, Gatino Rifatto. These are six guys, young guys, have been selected throughout the Italian schools, and they represent the best astronomers of their age in Italy. And I firmly believe that they represent a true example for all Italian youth. They have been training hard with their mind, with their heart, and they are ready to compete in this Olympic. Thank you, and let the best one win.
Thank you. And the next team is the Korea team. Korea, have to your microphone on.
Yeah, our main team is Professor Hyunjin Sim. You introduce her. She is in another place waiting.
Hi, I'm Hyunjin Sim from Korea. I'm the team leader, but unfortunately, I'm not with my student. I'll be joining my team tomorrow. So the students and the jury member and the team leader, Yuse Kim, they are in Seocho, say Seoul, which is the capital city of the Korea. Korea is, you all know that the recent BTS and the Squid Game Netflix series, so it must be a famous country to all of you. And in Astronomy part, in next year, 2022, we are going to have an IAU General Assembly in Busan. I hope that we can enjoy this Astronomy Olympiad kind of festival. So I would like to hold my microphone to the students.
Thank you. Now is the time for Malaysia team.
No, please.
Oh, what's up? Sorry. Please.
Okay. Our students will introduce themselves, one by one. So I'm another team leader, Yuja Kim, and starting from student code Alpha 1. Okay. Let's start. Okay, he is the first one, sorry.
Hello, I'm Won Ji Fun. Hi, my name is Won Kim.
Hi, my name is Jimin Lee.
Hello, my name is Taeyo Kim.
Hello, my name is Jiwon Jang.
Hello, my name is Sung Gi Kim.
Hi, I'm Seung Jun Ho.
Okay, there are seven students. And here is a he's not a student, but our technician. He's an important member of our team as well. Thank you very much. And okay, we are done with our introduction.
Okay, you're welcome. Now is the time for Malaysia team. He's connected. Malaysia. Not yet. Okay. We can go on with the Moscow land team.
Okay.
Hi.
Hello.
Hi.
Hi.
Hello.
We presented our team. We is glad to welcome other participants of the Olympiad. And we present our participants.
Hello, my name is Van Ignatiev, and I'm in the team of Moscow Land.
Okay. Hello, my name is Vasily Muratov. I'm in this team too.
Moscow Land.
Moscow Land.
Oh, my name is Tanya.
Hello, my name is Yekaterina. I'm Moscow Land too.
Hi, I'm Sven. I'm happy to be here.
I'm Catherine. I'm studying astrophysics. Otherwise, I'm very glad to compete in this Olympiads.
Hi, I'm Igor.
Okay, we wish good luck and interesting problems for all participants. Thank you.
Okay, bye. Thank you. You're welcome. You're welcome. Now is the time for a Nepal team. Is connected? Yes.
Hello.
Okay. Please.
Hello, I'm Manisha. We are from Nepal and our team are here. So I would like our team to introduce themselves.
So namaste everyone, I'm Rohan Acharya from team Nepal, Alpha 2.
Namaste everyone, I'm Alsam Gazrel, Alpha 3 from team Nepal. Namaste everyone, this is Bilal Matas from Nepal, team Peter.
Namaste everyone, I'm Pratish Kobir for Alpha 1.
Namaste, I am Kitesh Thakur, Team Nepal, Gamma 1.
Namaste, I'm Vipassana Vista, Beta 1 from Team Nepal.
Namaste, I'm Suresh Patrai, Team Leader and Jury for Team Nepal. Thank you.
I'm Manisha and I'm the Team Leader. So glad to see you all and we wish all the best to everyone here.
Namaste.
Bye-bye,
namaste.
Thank you. Now is the time for Romania team. Romania, okay, I see you. Please. Your microphone is switched off, maybe. Oh, there's some problem with the audio connection. Okay, we can go on. Ah, Romania, okay.
Okay.
Oh, thank you. But we don't have your head you.
PPT.
We don't hear your voice. Maybe there's some problem with your microphone. Sorry, but we don't have the audio, so okay. Sorry, but we don't have the audio, so okay. Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. Now is the time for Team Sweden.
Hello, do you hear us?
Yes.
Great. Hi, Filippa, team leader for the Swedish team. And we have...
I'm Anders, the jury member of the Swedish team.
And we have our three students here. Can...
Hello, my name is Philip.
My name is Lily.
My name is Sanya.
And we're gathered here in Stockholm in the old observatory in Stockholm for the test. Thank you. Anything?
You're welcome. Nice to see you. Now is the time for Thailand. Is connected? Yes, I can see you. Okay.
Yeah, hello. My name is Fondip. It's Ami Fong. I'm a team leader and also jury. Okay, I'm come along with another team leader, Soran Bibanchon.
Hi.
And our student, okay, will not be here until tomorrow. And here are our students, which will join the Alpha team for this competition. And we are very glad to join this competition. Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Stop in it.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Excuse me.
Okay. I think that we can go on. Oh, okay. Now is
okay. All right.
Time for USA team. Is connected. Okay, I can see you.
All right. Can you hear us? Elsie, can you hear us?
Yes.
All right. I think so. So, hi all. I'm Jack Lee. I'm the team leader for the USA team. We have some other more team leaders. I'd like to thank them: Jason Ling, Patricia Reif, and Cody Meng. They unfortunately cannot be here today. I was last in the IRAO 2 years ago as a competitor, so it's a pleasure to see a lot of familiar faces. I would thank our sponsor, Rice University, for being so accommodating, and I'd like to thank the LC for holding this event during such a difficult time. Without further ado, I'd like our competitors introduce themselves. Go ahead, start with Victor.
Hi, I'm Victor. My name is Victor Pang.
James Ling, Mr. White, and Cody Meng, the experts will not be here today.
I'm Adam. I'm a 10th grader from Illinois.
I'm Forrest O'Chen. I'm a 12th grader from Pennsylvania.
And I'm Ryan Zhang, and I'm a 10th grader from North Carolina.
We're done here. Thanks for your time.
Okay. Thank you. And now is the time for Vietnam team. Is connected? Okay, I can see you. Please.
Yeah. Hi, I will be doing the introduction for the Vietnamese team. Our team consists of 5 students, including me. I'm one of the students. I'm 12th grade and I'm in Hanoi. Now, 4 of my friends will introduce themselves.
Hi, my name is Thuyen. I'm group 11 and I study at Hanoi Amsterdam for Vietnam Student School. Okay.
Hello, my name is Chi and I'm in grade 12 and I also come from high school Vietnam students.
Hi, my name is Hung. I am to Nguyen Trai School.
Hi. You're really excited to be here.
Okay.
And we wish luck to every competitions. this is the end of our introduction.
Okay, thank you. Thank you so much. And so I am so grateful for all the team for the presentation, and we'll see you next time. We're starting tomorrow with the theoretical round, and you, I will send you a chronological calendar of the round, and so the same for the observational for the second day, and in third day for the practical round. Remember to you, to the team leader, do you remember if you can do some a video in for about 4 or 5 minutes that will show during the closing ceremony, just after, just before the awards, I mean. So bye bye to all, and we'll see you as soon. Bye bye.
Hi.
Thanks. Very thanks. See you.
See you.
Bye bye to everybody.